I was told that every lecturer introduces himself in more detail, and I didn't do that, so I should do that. I work in Center for Soft Matter Research in New York University. You can recognize that this is Manhattan, and we are located in the very middle of it, right here. It is a very urban place, as you can guess. And here, I think right there is the window of my office. So if you see very carefully, you may see me there. Those are members of the Center of Soft Matter Research, which is very exciting place, in my opinion. And two of them will come here as lecturers, Paul Chaykin and Mark White. You will see them lecturing here. So that's where I work now, and my background, I came to this country 20 years ago. My background is in Moscow. I was educated in Moscow University, where education was very rigorous in some aspects and very less than rigorous in other aspects. For instance, I had not heard the word DNA until the age of 25 or so. So yesterday someone mentioned high school biology, so I didn't have any biology in high school at all, no mention. So in university, my advisor was Ilya Lifshitz, and actually the name of Lifshitz was already mentioned here a few times in different contexts, and it will be mentioned again, I know, in other lectures, so I have to explain to you that there were two brothers. And you can imagine that their mother had to be very proud of such two famous brothers, both physicists. Evgeny, which means Eugene Lifshitz, was the older brother. He is the one who did the work that Phil Pinkus mentioned about Langevin's interactions. And also in other lectures later on, you will see Lifshitz's point, that is Lifshitz's older brother, Lifshitz. And he is also the author, one of the two authors of these famous books, which most of you, which all of you have seen from and some of you read some parts. Ilya Lifshitz was my teacher, and he was not part of this book series, but he was very, very exciting lecturer. I have to share with you the experience that coming out of his lectures was like, out of the shower. Intellectual shower. And he did a lot of things in physics, including Fermi surfaces of metals, disordered systems, and for instance, there is something that is called Lifshitz tail. Super solids, which were mentioned yesterday, and which is one of the fashionable topics in fermionic metaphysics now, were first predicted by Lifshitz. He did polymer. So that's about it. Now, back to more serious subject. We decided to expose you to a little more machinery of how polymer physics is done. And the reason for that is because we were all impressed by Professor Mahadevan's examples when you can analyze tsunami and nuclear explosion and everything else like that. But the fact of the matter is, if you are Mahadevan, maybe you can do it. But for us simple mortals, some more down-to-earth roads should be explored. And I want to show to you some of these down-to-earth roads. The underlying message that I want to say is that although we'll be doing some relatively formal manipulations like doing mathematics, when you are a physicist and you do mathematics, you still have to watch for physics of what you are doing all the time. It's not that you just take some ingredients and turn the crank of your meat grinder and get the answer. You have to watch what you that's what I want to tell. To begin with, let me start commenting on Lori Huygens' formula that we had, that Michael Rubinstein derived for you yesterday, and I repeat this formula here, that is mixing free energy per one side. It's little n here is the number of sides, which is a little mysterious what you should use by the side, but phi is the volume fraction of units A, and 1 minus phi is the volume fraction of units B, and so on, and you heard all of that. I want to emphasize that yesterday you had many questions about these equations, about the derivations of these equations. And the reason why you had many questions, and let me be intentionally provocative here, the reason why you have many questions is because this formula is very poorly justified. It is not a formula which is rigorously derived from anything. It's just a reasonable interpolation, not more than that. And the way you interpret it and the way it was presented yesterday was that this part is entropy of mixing and this part is energy. Then, later on, Michael said this chi equals A plus B divided by T, which immediately suggests to you that it's not purely energy, but there is some entropy there, so. And later on, if you read literature, you discover that chi depends on some other things, and so on. So, there is an alternative interpretation of such formula. Let us say that this is entropy ideal gas of change. This is simply entropy of ideal gas, which means it is entropy of translational motion of change as a whole, as unit. And in this translational motion, they don't see each other. They just move independently from one another, and that's what this term counts. And everything else, let's call it interaction part. Everything else is interaction of one sort or another. That part looks like more excluded volume interaction. That part involves maybe attraction and repulsion in some proportion. But let's just call this attraction. And such point of view, actually, in my opinion, presents significant advantages. Why it presents significant advantages, you can immediately conclude from the first lecture this morning. You hear, we all have seen, enormous zoo of various phases. Just a normal zoo of all possible types of phases. The very fact that they exist suggest to you that, of course, this formula, however nice, is not the end of the story. Because there are other condensed objects which exhibit many, many more different phases in complex behavior. Therefore, if you write it just simply as interaction part, you allow yourself to later on introduce there all other sorts of things, including all sorts of liquid crystals or whatever you may see. In this regard, Let me remind you this picture which you have seen yesterday about this free and mixing free energy as a function of volume fraction. It's a function of volume fraction, and there is this common tangent construction which allows you to decide when whether there is or there is no phase segregation. When you hear your general physics introductory physics text in the part of on phase real gases in phase transitions, you learn van der Waals equation. Van der Waals equation is pressure as a function of volume, and it has this characteristic loop, and you were taught that the way to construct phase segregation, to find the densities of coexisting phases, is to draw horizontal line through this, and line should be horizontal because both phases have to have the same pressures, just for mechanical equilibrium. And that construction and this construction seems to be different. So I offer to you this as an exercise to establish that these two are actually identical, and they've been the same. This common tangent construction is the same as drawing horizontal line here and finding coexisting densities. It is the same thing. You can also, since they told you that this is not the only possible interpolation formula, you can develop a competing theory based on van der Waals equation and try to find out whether it's better or worse, or in which sense it's better. What are advantages or disadvantages, or why people in experimental field in polymers use fluoric agens and do not use van der Waals, whether it's because of some tradition or because of something else. So I leave it for you to decide. Okay, so with this in mind, with this idea of F interaction in mind, let us think again about ideal chain. So ideal chain is exactly where this F interaction is equal to zero. So how do we look at ideal chain? Now I want to offer to you a little more advanced point of view than the one compared to the one which I suggested in my first lecture. And this will be the following. If I have a chain, first of all, I have to decide how much I want to learn about this chain. And let us say that we want to study its conformation to some degree of details, which means we will be looking at particular representative points, representative models. Maybe all monomers, but not necessarily all monomers. We want to be looking at some set of representative monomers. They are located in given conformation. They are located in particular points. But in fact, this axis may involve some other things, such as, for instance, their internal states. If this is some biopolymer which undergoes helix coil transition, so in the value of x, you can include not only position, but also information about whether it's a helix or coil or something else, or about orientation of this particular segment. And so if these representative points are not particularly close to one another, specifically if they are further away than one Kuhn segment, then the probability distribution of distance between them, and distance is this vector y, the probability distribution of distance is Gaussian. That's what we discussed. And the length here, the length A, is actually not the millisecond. The length here is, depends on what you have chosen as a representative point. If you have chosen very far away representative point, then you would say long game. So it's a question of your choice. So if you now want to know what is the probability to observe certain conformation, which is characterized by the set of this axis, then the probability to obtain certain conformation is the product of these little g's. And the fact that these g's form just simple product is because we didn't have so far any interaction here. It's independent pieces. Every step is independent, statistically independent of other steps. So this is, if you have, besides coordinates in your axis, you have internal states such as helix and coil, or you have also orientation of the segments, then you cannot say that these g's will be dependent on distances, x1 minus x2. They depend on x1 and x2 separately. And of course, this g, little g, is a probability, so it's properly normalized and so on. Now, if you want to switch to less detailed description. Now, you were describing your chain in terms of these red monomers, red units, red representative points. Let's call them representative points. If you want to switch to less detailed description, which means you want to watch only on the green guys, then instead of your original G, you have to integrate over all silent silent axes in between. For instance, between this green guy and this green guy, there are two red ones, and you have to integrate away a couple of red guys, and then you obtain little g, which connects this green guy. And then, of course, it is a delicate issue what you want to do with the ends. This issue will show up again. So one thing, one useful object that we can think about is Hawking's function. And this is essentially, in this context, just simply the probability that your first monomer sits in the point x and monomer number n sits in the point x prime. And similarly to what we did here, I will say that we can find it by integrating over all intermediate axes. But we can also do something else. We can notice that this thing very trivially satisfies nice equation. If you take this probability for chain of one more representative point, you add one thing at the end. Then the probability for such longer object to have n's at points x and x double prime will be the probability for the shorter one to go from x to some x prime, and then the probability for one extra point to go from x prime to x double prime. And then x prime can be anywhere. So you have to integrate over x. So in brief, this is this very nice simple equation. What this equation means, let us try to decipher this symbol you have, and let's imagine the simple case when our x is a set of coordinates, three Cartesian coordinates. And our, let's assume that our representative points are not too frequent. So therefore we have this Gaussian, nice Gaussian G. You see this Gaussian that is what we discussed this. Now I will argue that this G, when you have a head, it's an operator, it's nothing like the exponential of Laplacian. If you are, do not feel comfortable with exponential Laplacian, don't hesitate. It's very simple. Just let's imagine that we write this whole in K space in Fourier form. Then Gaussian will be this, right? Fourier transform of Gaussian is Gaussian. So minus K square, on the other hand, is nothing else but the Laplacian that you also. So this is exponential of the Laplacian. So our equation is this. Now under proper conditions, exponential, what should we do with exponential? Exponential is either very big or should be expanded. By the way, I told you that in Moscow University, training in some aspects was extremely rigorous. In particular, I had full year course on series, mathematical series. And I came out of this course with firm conviction that the purpose of series, what for they are, the purpose of them is to investigate their convergence. Now I grew up cynical and I don't know that the purpose of infinite series is to throw away all terms except one. Or maybe on occasion two. So, speaking about that, when you have this exponential, under proper circumstances, which we will discuss, you can expand this and you see this. Also, probably this probability changes a little bit if your n is very large. Then this you can also expand and you get the derivative. And then these complex looking equations become very familiar. So this is just your familiar friend diffusion equation. And we will have to discuss when it's possible to do this. So if you have this diffusion equation, then the solution of diffusion equation, as Phil Pinkus told you, you know how to solve differential equations because you know the solutions. So the solution of this equation you know very well, and this is your Gaussian thing. I want to tell you that, of course, in this case, we didn't produce anything. It's just turning around. We obtained what we introduced in our consideration, because we decided that every bond is Gaussian, so then it's not a big deal that the whole thing is Gaussian. Nothing new. But it's nice to see that it's consistent. But we can actually pretend to produce something new, and here is challenging the exercise for you. So here is this operator. When the representative points are so infrequent along the chain that the bond between the representative points is a Gaussian. Imagine now that you have a worm-like chain that we discussed previous time. You have a worm-like chain like this, and you choose your representative points very frequently. Then, of course, your x should be position vector and direction. And you have to decide how to formulate operator g for this speed. That's a very interesting exercise, and I have to tell you that later on, you will see how this is similar with this operator, it's similar to quantum mechanics, to Schrodinger equation. And in the early days of quantum mechanics, when quantum mechanics was not yet established, there was an attempt to develop competing form of quantum mechanics, which was based on the same. It was done by Oscar Klein. Okay, so let's analyze now under which conditions we can do these simple expansions. So what we have here is for probability of the conformation is one Gaussian times another Gaussian times one more Gaussian. So if you open it up, it looks like this. And if you now imagine that you have great many of these points, then instead of writing it as x2 minus x3 and so on in discrete form, you can imagine that we have like a function x as a function of monomer number s, and then what that is dx ds squared. So if you interpret s as a time, then it's velocity. So it looks like very much like exponential of kinetic energy, and then we have the integral over the whole chain, which means integral over time. That you may have seen such formulas somewhere. But we will discuss it more. If you don't want to know the probability of the whole conformation, which is given by this whole function, then you will want to integrate over all intermediate points, which means you want to integrate, it's called path integral, and some people are afraid of it, but it's nothing more than just integration over all the intermediate axes. So this is, again, probability to get from x to x prime in n steps, and this is, you can also consider it as the partition sum of our polymer, the sum over all information. Now,
there will be an implicit constraint there. In that line, you have an implicit constraint that you sum of all points, but in the middle, you have some delta function constraints.
I don't have any delta function constraints in the middle at all. I have the only constraints so far. There will be other constraints, but so far the only constraints are that I see at the beginning in x and at the end at x prime.
Those are the ends of the
polymer. Those are the ends of the polymer. That's right.
So what's your capital D?
Huh?
What's your the capital D in the end?
What's what?
The capital D.
Capital D. Oh, that's a good question. Capital D means that it's a path integral. It's not the integral over one particular s. It's the over one particular x. It is integral over all of them together. It's a summation over all possible trajectories. You have integral of whatever capital D x of s means nothing else but the sum over entire zoo of trajectories, including this trajectory and this trajectory and this trajectory and this trajectory, and I'm getting tired drawing it. So, clever people, instead of saying the sum over all possible curves, invented this symbol. This symbol is called path integral, and that's what it is. Okay? And clever people means mark cuts. And Feynman famously used it in quantum mechanics, but first it was invented by Mark Cutts. Now I told you that this is, I told you actually two things. I told you that this is probability, and I told you that this is also a partition sum. If you do the partition sum completely, which means you integrate over n's, then since this is the probability, I will finish saying, since this is probability, the integral should be 1 because probability is normal. But it is also partition sum. What does it mean that partition sum is 1?
If we find that the probability distribution of a polymer is same as the propagator of a random walk, so if you take a colored random walk or colored noise random walk, can you get a real real chain probability distribution?
No, for the good reason which we will discuss in full. But the brief answer is no. And the meaning, so first maybe I should explain that what in this case would be colored random walk. That would mean that these G functions are not Gaussian. Something else. But multiplicative structure will still be the same. And this is the signature of ideal polymer. Non-ideal polymer is non-multiplicative structure. Okay, so back to my question. What does it mean that partition sum is one? For those who know what is log of 1. What is log of 1? Who said 0? Okay. So, assuming it is 0, what does it mean?
Free energy.
Free energy is 0. What does that mean? That means nothing else but the fact that we chose to consider this unrestricted ideal chain to be 0 level of free energy. You know, free energy is always defined up to additive constant. So if you, as long as you don't compare different free energies, the fact that one particular free energy equals 0 means nothing except the fact that you have chosen this state to be 0 level of free energy. So by considering these probabilities normalized, we've chosen unrestricted, unaffected ideal polymer to be our 0 level of free energy.
Now, strictly speaking, you define this G as the conditional probability. So it's only when you integrate over one end that you get 1. So then you have to integrate over the other end to get the value. So in reality, you actually get log B, right?
Beautiful. That's excellent. Thank you. That's when you are lecturing to students who tend to sleep, then you keep under the rug such things. Thank you. You are absolutely right. If you integrate over both ends, then what you obtain by integrating over one end is all the sum over all conformations of your chain with one end fixed, which means that is the zero level of free energy. If you now integrate over the other end, that means you take your coil and place it anywhere inside your volume, and then, of course, your free energy will be log V, which means you have one particle located in infinite volume. That's absolutely true. And it is mathematically also true that if you look at this thing, integrated over everything except one of them. Okay? But the fact that you can write this as a function, as this path integral, suggests that your diffusion equation could be directly written down from looking at this based on what people have done in the theory of random walks. So therefore, you can do continue limit either by doing this Taylor expansion here and Taylor expansion here, or by doing it like this through the passing here. Those are two parallel roads that lead to the same result. Let's now go a bit more general, and let's imagine that each of these representative points feels some potential, lives in some potential one state, which depends on the same x. Then instead of our object like this, which is to the probability, we now have something else, and here I assume temperature to be 1. We have to incorporate here between this g of going from x1 to x2 and this from going to x2 to x3, we have to have that this monomer number 2 fills energy e to minus phi. It has energy phi, has power e to minus phi. What do we do about n's? It is a little bit open question, since we are dealing with the representative, so you can imagine that this guy somehow tells you about energy of the whole piece of polymer from here to here. Okay? So in the end, you have only one half of it. So whether you want to incorporate this potential at the end, or you don't want to incorporate this potential at the end, be careful about it. Sometimes you do have to do it, sometimes you don't. Okay, so in continuous limit, what happens is if you have this in continuous limit, and now you insert potentials in every place, then what happens is you have this. Now you have this velocity squared plus potential. And that looks very much like integral of kinetic energy minus potential energy, something that is called Lagrangian, and this integral would then be called action, and then exponential of it, it's something that is in quantum mechanics important, but there you have kinetic energy minus potential energy. Here you have analog of kinetic energy plus. So this phi plays the role of minus potential energy. And that has a big physical meaning, as you will see. So if you want to integrate our intermediate points, you do again this pass integral with this type of thinking, the exponential. This is still partition sum of the chain with fixed n. And so you can do everything, but now it's time to discuss under which conditions this continuous limit applies. So for these Taylor expansions to be valid, you should make sure that nothing changes significantly over the length scale of Kuhn segment. If your Kuhn segment is smaller than all other characteristic lengths, then you can choose a representative point, which has to be further away than Kuhn segments, and choose them such that, for instance, if your phi changes over a length scale lambda, which is bigger than Kuhn segment, then you can choose your representative points such that your A, the distance between representative points, sits between Kuhn segment and lambda. And then since A is greater than B, your G of Y is Gaussian. But since lambda is greater than A, so your A squared of Laplacian is still small, and you can do expansion. So this is the condition. So if you do this condition, then you can do various interesting things. One thing, you can immediately generalize. Here you have energy of, which depends on one monomer sitting in some potential. This is external field, maybe some consistent field. But you can also imagine doing similar thing with two-body interaction. Or if this interaction potential is short range, you can replace it with delta function. And then this becomes very difficult and very subject of many interesting studies, which I will not touch. But I will do instead something more physical, that the idea of which belongs to Simonov already almost 30 years ago. And the idea is the following. Let us consider a polymer chain which is attached to the top of some potential hill. So I asked my daughter to draw something that is attached to the top of the hill, and she said the hill should have flowers. And I thought maybe it's not so appealing picture, so I found another type of things that are, those are roads in Chile, which I must tell you that as a driver, I have never experienced anything more more exciting. In any case, it looks very much like a polymer which hangs from the top of the hill. So if it hangs from the top of the hill, then you can imagine that, in fact, the trajectory that the guy would choose would correspond to the minimum of this object. Right? The most probable trajectory will correspond to the minimum of this object, to the minimum of this. And minimum of this is, of course, nothing else but the minimal action. And minimal action corresponds to the classical motion of particle whose speed it is, whose energy is minus phi. Remember this minus. So this minimum, this leads to the dictionary. S, coordinate along the polymer is time. 3 over a squared is mass. This derivative is velocity. Phi is minus potential. And it is important. So how do you solve such thing in classical mechanics? You know everything. You write force equals ma, or you write the energy is conserved. Kinetic energy plus potential energy, and potential energy minus phi is E. And then you can find the free energy and everything. But I want you to memorize for me this simple equation. So now let us, yes.
So suppose I want to write down a path integral for a random walk in a potential.
That's what I'm doing.
So So why would you need the minus sign in the potential? If I write the Lagrangian, I'll just write it as plus, right?
Okay, so here you have exponential of, that is without the potential. With potential you have minus x dot squared and minus phi. You don't have minus potential here. However, if you look at this formula, it looks like quantum mechanics formula. Except here you have kinetic energy x dot squared plus phi, and here you're supposed to have kinetic energy minus potential energy. Therefore, your phi plays the role of minus potential energy. in this mapping to classical mechanics plays the role of minus potential. It is for polymer, it is potential energy, but it plays the role of minus potential energy for.
So now, if I write down, start with a Lagrangian for a like randomly moving random walk, then would I get this correct sign?
Yes.
Okay.
If you do it, well, let me take it back. What do you mean? You write Lagrangian for random walk. If you write your Hamiltonian for your polymer, there is no kinetic energy. It's pure equilibrium statistical mechanics, no kinetic energy. This is formally similar to kinetic energy of representative particle. It's not kinetic energy of the polymer. And what? Variables, radius are now off. So this is potential energy of your polymer, and this is actually elastic stretching entropy of your polymer. Okay? And it is analogous to this quantum mechanical formula in which phi is minus potential. Accordingly, when you write your classical mechanics conservation of energy, then you have analog of kinetic energy minus phi, which means plus analog of potential energy. And you will see why it must be like this. So let's use this for a brush. Example of a brush. Brush is this thing which brush was mentioned already several times. So brush, you have chains which are attached to this solid substrate, and they get stretched because it's too dense here. They don't have room to wiggle right and left, which means that there is, for each of them, there is some potential which is big here, which is kind of, I try to demonstrate by this shape. So this potential okay, so this potential is dense and high potential here and becomes progressively lower out there. And each of them, so it's kind of mean field picture, and I will tell you under which conditions this mean field picture is applicable. So each chain now is represented effectively as a particle which moves according to this energy conservation law in the potential field phi of x, but kinetic energy, potential energy, given fixed energy. And this particle starts at x equals 0, goes out and ends at some point x equal little h. In the time, and time is analogous to length along the polymer, so the time at end is m. So times are the same for all of the chains, but the distances are different. That means your potential is such that the period is independent of amplitude. The potential for the particle, which is minus phi, so you have your phi, which is like this, and you have your potential for the particle, which is therefore like this, and the potential must be such that period, which is, you start here, go time n this way, time n back, time n here, time n here. So the period will be 4n. So the period is independent of amplitude. Have you heard such thing for pendulums? That period is independent of amplitude. According to the story that I heard, Galileo, during Sunday Mass, yes, he was probably not very attentively listening to what was happening, because apparently, according to the story, he was watching oscillations of candelabra in the church, and using his own pulse as a chronometer, he measured period of these oscillations. And he noticed that the period was the same whether oscillations were quite strong or only very weak. So it's called isochronous property of the regular pendulum. In fact, for angular pendulum, it's only approximate. But for harmonic oscillator, you know that the frequency of harmonic oscillator is like that. Okay? So the frequency of harmonic oscillator is independent of the amplitude. And you can show it, or you can read it in classical mechanics textbook, that this property is only for harmonic oscillator. For any other oscillator, frequency will depend on the amplitude. So here, frequency is independent of the amplitude, and therefore, this must be a harmonic oscillator. So it's incredible. Out of this almost nothing, we are able to find that it should be x squared. It's called parabolic profile. So it's very clever, actually, that phi is minus u, because, of course, this phi, the real potential for the polymer is like that. There will be no oscillations. So oscillations happen in minus phi, in such. Okay? So it's really clever. Moreover, polymer is most stretched here, which corresponds to the biggest speed. And the speed at the end, the speed of the particle at the end, should be zero, which means the polymer is not stretched at the end. So since I told you already that period should be 4n, quarter period should be n, you can reconstruct what is the rigidity constant here. And from here, since you know already this potential, you can use this conservation law, which we discussed, and you can find velocity at the height h, and you can easily establish that density is actually inverted velocity. So here is your density. Here is very interesting exercise. You have to show that monomer number S typically sits at the height which is given by this formula. Okay, the exercise is do that. And now you have to find the density. Density of the brush looks like this, which is already strange. So if you plot it, plot it, blows up at the point little h, where the end is. Is it plausible that the density of brush looks like that? It's attached, grafted at this point, and then, is it plausible?
So this density of the ends or density of the brush?
This is density of
the end.
No, this is density of monomers. So,
is it graphed or just, I'm getting confused that, so the n is kept at distance h, but another n is graphed.
Okay, that's exactly the point. What happens is we have your brush, which is grafted here, and then if you have one particular chain which ends at the point H, then as a function of X, its density, the density of monomers of this particular chain in the brush looks like this. Make it right. For this particular chain, yes, its density is highest here because it is strongly stretched here. It does not want to live here. It rushes out of this place. It is very strongly stretched. But here it's not strongly stretched, and so here it has more movement.
I have a quick question. Sorry, maybe I missed it, but does dimensionality not matter at all? Or are we talking about, I mean, are we talking about polymers that are grafted onto a surface, or is it onto a 1D line?
It's
or does
on,
it not matter?
It's on the surface, and this is, well, this is density. It has units of 1 over lambda,
yes,
which means it is the number of monomers in this interval of this.
Yeah, so it's the number density along the line that we're talking about
it's
here.
But row 1, dx is the number of monomers sitting in this layer between x and x plus dx. Okay?
But does it matter whether these, maybe it comes into the mean field approximations, but does it matter whether you have polymers that are all grafted onto a two-dimensional surface versus polymers which are just grafted along a line?
So far, we have one polymer sitting in this external field phi.
Yes.
And now we have to decide how we deal with.
Okay, and that should depend on dimensionality.
That will depend on. That will include the grafting density.
Okay.
And the permanence of the density is due to the fact that the chain must stop at the end.
This divergence is due to the fact that the chain at the end is not at all stretched. The more you stretch your chain, the smaller is density per unit interval of thickness. So the divergence at the end is because the end is not stretched at all, so the chain is happy there. So yes, many people already wanted me to say total density of this object involves density of one chain, but then there are many chains and they have their ends a different value of little h. Okay? So I have to have the end, the function at the end will be c of h. The probability that your particular polymer ends at the height h is c of h, and then you have to find this c of h, and then total density will be like this, where sigma is the number of chains grafted per unit area here, and therefore this row is now units of inverted cubic length. So now I have to find this C. How I do that? I will say that there is self-consistency condition that this phi counted from the common upper end of the whole brush where density is zero. This phi is simply virial coefficient, proper virial coefficient, the volume, whatever that is, times this total base.
Okay.
Now the rest is pure algebra, because I know already that phi is parabolic, I know this row 1, I obtain this equation, and I will skip algebra. Algebra is something that we have to do once in a while. And here is your complete answer. This is total height of the brush, which goes linear in n, which means your chains are stretched significantly. And then this is the probability distribution of the heights of the chain ends. So this is shown here. This is total density, which is proportional to our parabolic potential. And this is the probability distribution of the chain ends. So ends are everywhere in the, throughout this brush. And you see that it corresponds very well to the data. But my point here, since I am concentrating on the method, my point is not so much on the algebra and all that. My point is that is the major that is the major point. From this isochronous property of the pendulum, we conclude this. Okay. So now I have to tell you under which conditions this mean field approximation applies, and this is easy because you are well prepared for that. You have to assume that the thermal blob, which is the distance needed to develop correlations which are due to self-avoidance of the chain, thermal blob should be larger than the distance to the neighboring chain. If you don't have room to develop these correlations, then you don't do it. Yes.
You say we should be very careful with what we put the item in the end, or we use it. Because if you put it in this case, whether you can put it in the chain,
again.
You remember when
the end of the chain. Here, whether you have something at the end of the chain or you don't, plays very, very little role, completely negligible role, because the field changes so smoothly that adding or subtracting one unit at the end makes no difference. So that's not the problem. Okay, so now let's go back to this green function, and now...
I got stuck on the logical connection that you made between the brush and the harmonic oscillator, because the entire form of the potential seems to hinge on the logical connection between those two. How were you able to determine that it should be an X square?
Okay, I said the following, okay? Imagine my original picture of the brush, which is this brush. So now I look at different chains. Different chains end at different points, but have the same length. So they, A, live at the same potential, B have the same length, and C end at different points. So, end at different points, or I should say, every chain corresponds to one particular particle, one particular pendulum. All pendula live in the same potential. Having end points in different places means having different amplitudes.
Okay.
Having the same length means having oscillating for the same time, means having the same peak.
Well, I see the allegory. I don't see why it should be a harmonic, why it should be a harmonic oscillator.
That is theorem from classical mechanics. Only harmonic oscillator has this problem. If you have non-harmonic oscillator, you don't have this property. I can, for instance, give you an intuition why regular pendulum doesn't have this property. Regular pendulum, the potential for regular pendulum as a function of angle in this case, the potential for regular pendulum is harmonic at the beginning, but then it goes like this. I meant it to be of the same kind. Right? So this is pendulum hanging down, and this is pendulum looking straight up. Right? Is that clear? Okay, so if you have certain potential, a certain period of oscillations, it's small amplitude here, certain period. Now if you approach, if your amplitude approaches here, then you go here, here you go with very, very slow speed. And eventually, if you, your amplitude is exactly like this, your period is infinite. So that means your period is an increasing function of amplitude. So you can prove that the only potential in which isochronous property is really the harmonic oscillator.
Status quo one.
Yeah, just real quick, that's a couple of questions. But the self-consistency condition where you relate the field to the density, I don't understand how you handle that.
How I handled that or how I wrote that?
I kind of under either one.
Okay, so do you understand that potential should be proportional to density?
Okay, I didn't know that you could just sort of assume that.
Okay, let us postpone this because we will return to this in a different form in a few slides.
Nice.
But if I forget, you might, yes.
So I'm going to continue maybe this question about, so why do you assume that this is a periodic motion? Why is this like, I understand what you're saying, that it is equivalent to look at the particle doing a motion in a potential field. But why is this a periodic motion, which then means that the period has to be the same for different amplitudes?
Well, of course, what I really watch for the polymer is only quarter period. It goes from here to here, or from here to here, and that's the only thing that I want. However, if I look at the equation, what the equation will do? The equation will keep going back and forth. So equation, this equation, I only watch quarter period, but this equation is the equation of, a priori, I don't know if it's harmonic oscillator or not, but I know that quarter period of whatever oscillator is that is independent of the amplitude.
Are you saying that the speed of this effective particle is basically going to be zero at that quarter period, so that you know that you can retrace it backwards?
Yeah.
So that's the big deal. So the speed is going to be zero at the end.
Yeah.
So I'm under the impression that at first we assume the hyperbolic profile of the potential, and then we show that it's consistent with the assumption. Isn't it right?
No, it's not right. It is not. We really derive this parabolic profile based on the isochronous property, on the fact that different chains have different lengths. Different end positions and the same length. Okay, so let's go back to this nice formula and let's look at it from in differently. Let's look not in quote unquote classical limit, or you can call it Simeonov limit if you want, and let's look at it in very quantumly. You know that this is the same thing as in quantum mechanics. So in the opposite limit, when you have many trajectories, not one particular single trajectory that wins, but many trajectories that contribute, then this thing satisfies Schrödinger equation. So this part of it, without the potential, this part of it, we saw already that's the diffusion equation. Now we have to incorporate this difference. And so this is this. This is very important. This is why I... So here is a little piece of more formal mathematics that, if you remember quantum mechanics lectures, you should do it easily. Since you have kind of Schrödinger equation, you know that the most interesting thing are, of course, energy levels, and the equation for energy levels, stationary Schrödinger equation, looks like this, lambda k are energy levels number k, and then your g, you can expand in the form of expand over your eigenvolts, you can say, and since it's symmetric of x and x prime, you have to write it this way. You can check it. Then if you substitute it back, you discover that your coefficients look like this, and then this is the only thing that you have to do. Now you see that at large n, it dies away if lambda is positive, and therefore the only thing that remains is the smallest lambda. The smallest lambda corresponds to the lowest energy level, which is ground state. This is called the ground state dominance. If the ground state dominates, then your T becomes your G, which is structure, it means that the probability distribution of x and probability distribution of x prime, which are two ends, they become independent. The thing wanders at the depths of potential wealth, and two ends become independent from one another. Statistically, they are decoupled from one another. And this psi and lambda are solutions of this quantum mechanics. So you can do various examples here. For instance, you can remember your quantum mechanics exercises, and you can remember that your typical wave function of ground state looks like this. It does not look like this, which is important because since G is partition sum, it better be positive, right? So it should not have oscillations like this, but luckily ground state never has oscillations like this. So psi is the wave function of the ground state. You can do various exercises. One nice thing that you can remember is that it's phi is in fact phi divided by kT. So if you have your potential divided by kT, then effective potential at high temperature will be like that. But this will be high temperature. And at low temperature, it will be like this. So at low temperature, you have energy level here. At high temperature, this is too shallow a well, and you don't have well. Temperature at which discrete level first appears corresponds to a phase transition. So here.
So that's, but that's very sensitive to dimensionality.
That's extremely sensitive to dimensionality, and this is one of these challenging cases.
Oh, I didn't see, sorry.
But that's good, thank you. I'm sorry. Indeed, in depending on dimensionality, these conditions are very different, and not only on dimensionality, but also on the boundary conditions. For instance, if your potential is asymmetric like that, or symmetric like that, and so on. So it's indeed quite sensitive, and you have a number of challenging exercises. In particular, you want to know what type of, whether it's first order condition or second order condition. You have to analyze that in this. Okay, so now another thing that you may want to know, since you know this result for green function, you may want to know what is free energy. Free energy is very easy to establish because you, in order to find your partition sum, you just integrate over this n, and you obtain that your free energy per particle is nothing else but this little lambda. Now, if you want to find density of this object, then what you have to do is you have to consider three-point Green function for the polymer that starts at monomer 1 sits at x prime. Some intermediate monomer m sits at x. And final monomer n sits at x double prime. Then this is similar to this one, except I forgot the minus. But importantly, this is psi of this point times psi of this point, and then psi of x prime, right? And this does not depend on m, on intermediate monomer. So therefore, what we have is n equals psi squared, which, of course, given that your psi is positive, it is the same thing you could have written absolute value psi square, in which case you would recognize it as quantum mechanical probability. So your n, apart from normalization, your density is nothing else but quantum mechanical probability. Yes?
I didn't really understand how to calculate the order of the assumptions.
Could you speak up, please?
Pardon me?
Could you speak up, please?
Okay. So I didn't really understand how you could calculate the order of the phase transition or something by solving this solution of the equation.
Okay. How you can calculate is, of course, the thing that I wanted you to do.
Okay. But I didn't really understand the relation with phase transitions.
Okay. Do you understand that at low temperature you have a deep potential well, at high temperature you have shallow potential.
Yeah.
If you have deep potential well, there might be level, energy level. Mm-hmm. If you have shallow potential well, there is no energy level, which means your free energy is zero. Now, here your free energy is negative, is equal to the value of this energy level. So therefore, if you plot free energy and a function of temperature, then there is some critical temperature above which you have your free energy is zero, and below which your free energy is not zero. It's this level. So what happens here? You cannot possibly connect smoothly something that is identical zero to something that is not. But this is some sort of phase transition. What is the meaning of this phase transition? You have your polymer which is spread everywhere, And now the polymer all of a sudden is confined here. Yes.
But that transition can be very, it can very smoothly change from zero to a deep potential.
So you are saying that it can be smooth high order phase transition, right? That's what you are saying.
We, for example, for such x squared kind of potential, it looks like it was smoothly crossover from one shallow potential to a deep one. Or
once again, in one case, you don't have energy already, and your free energy is zero. In the other case, you do have potential level and your energy is lambda, something. It's not zero, something. There is no way to connect smoothly zero, a constant, with something that is not a constant.
But that zero can only happen at C equals
No, it's zero. Oh, that may be a good point to explain. If you have potential well of this size, you have very long polymer, even if the end of it is the beginning of it, sits in the potential well, if your polymer is sufficiently long, it will wander away from the field. If it is not kept in the field, if it is not forced to return back again and again and again inside this same potential well, it will wander somewhere. Right? Mm-hmm. If you imagine a student who is not forced to come to the lecture every morning and is left for a long time unsupervised, I mean, he or she is probably not inside the campus of the university. So, and then the energy is zero. The energy is exactly. Now I'm running out of time, and I have to make a decision. I will probably spend 5 more minutes, and then I will come to some logical point. So we discovered that density is psi squared, just quantum, like quantum mechanical probability. Then what we can do is we can find entropy, which is an interesting formula. So entropy I will find by knowing free energy and density, I will find it. I will say that entropy is defined by this way, just to understand. Now this symbol of dot product or scalar product, which is here, is meant to be the integral over all volumes. Integral of n times potential, that would be energy divided by temperature, right? That would be energy, and this will be free energy because the lambda is a constant, so integral of little n would be big M, number of monomers. So now I replace little n with psi squared, and then here is phi over t minus lambda. Phi over t minus lambda is, according to my Schrödinger equation, is nothing else but this guy, dot Lushin. So what I end up is this nice formula, which is the formula for which is the formula, this is actually Lifshitz formula for entropy, and this tells you that a few interesting things. First of all, it tells you that entropy is zero when you don't have special when your state is uniform, That's exactly what Michael referred to yesterday as Flores theorem, not theory, but theorem. That's an important distinction, that in uniform system, your polymers are Gaussian, and therefore entropy, they are not entropically disturbed, the entropy is here. That's what you obtain here. Another thing is, if you imagine that your psi changes over some length scale r, then this Laplacian will be 1 over r squared, and you recover the entropy formula that Michael gave to you by some hand-waving argument regarding confinement inside the distance of order r. And he said that was not enough to compensate, and you needed to stabilize two-body attraction by three-body repulsion. That's what he said, but that we recovered. And now the final thing that we need to do is we need to do the self-consistency. The self-consistency is something that I want to do as the last statement. So self-consistency essentially means now that instead of particle, quantum mechanical particle, which is living in some externally given potential well, you have a particle which digs the well for itself. It has a shovel and digs the well and falls into it. Okay? So how does it work? I told you it in my first slide or second slide of this lecture that let's not restrict ourselves to Flory-Huggins interpolation, let's do it in general. So this F star is free energy interaction part of free energy per unit volume. You may write it in the form of Flory-Huggins or not write it in the form of Flory-Huggins, just interaction part. And this is your entropy, which we just derived, minus T entropy. Okay, so if you now minimize this quantity with respect to psi, which is order parameter, you obtain back this Schrödinger equation, except now this is what? This is the derivative of this free energy with respect to density. So now I have my interaction part of free energy, which here I switch to write as F star, and the derivative of interaction part of free energy with respect to density is interaction part of chemical potential. So this is interaction part of chemical potential. And that, I forgot who asked me about the self-consistency construction in the brush. Who did? Okay. So that's exactly what happened. If you have, this is, in general, self-consistent field. Self-consistent. And if you have, since it is only interaction part, it doesn't have any ideal gas part. So therefore, if you have virial expansion, then it will look like this. And that's what I used in the brush. Okay? So that is now nonlinear partial differential equation, which we have to address, and you can say many interesting things about it. You can use the expansion and so on and so forth, we'll reach it over this time. But the point is, it does reproduce all the quantities that, all the results that Michael mentioned yesterday, except maybe to conclude, I will tell you one result that you can extract this way from this consideration, which you cannot extract from giving the law of arguments that Michael gave to you, which is, yes, if you have this self-consistently constructed globular, you may want to know what is its density. So its density you can derive in very general form, and it is determined by the condition that interaction part of osmotic pressure at the density of equilibrium globula equals zero. That would be valid independently of whether you work with very dilute system where you have virial expansion or you have inside your globula complicated set of liquid crystalline pieces oriented groups, whatever. Interaction part of this osmotic pressure should be zero. Why? This has very simple physical meaning. Your globula is surrounded by empty solvent. There are no polymers. So, in order to balance mechanical forces at the boundary, you have to make sure that osmotic pressure is balanced. Osmotic pressure normally would involve ideal gas part, entropic part, and interaction part. But now you have one single chain. It does not have inside itself, it doesn't have any degrees of freedom of independent movement. Therefore, there is no entropic part. And the only thing that there is the interaction part of pressure, which must therefore be zero. That determines the density of globula. And, but the idea is still, of course, the same that that attraction part of forces balance the repulsion part of force. So there is a challenging problem, which you have printed out, so you can read it. If you keep your polymer inside a potential bubble, that solution corresponds to ideal polymer, so absolute volume equals zero. That is the mode which you can find in quantum mechanics text. But on the other hand, you know that if you have a logic fluid volume, it cannot allow itself the luxury of having low density here because here density is too high. So the density will have to be like this. And then the question is, what is the self-consistent potential? How you can construct self-consistent potential which produces flat density? Okay, so I almost completed, and here is the summary, so we can stop. I'm sorry, I took 10 minutes. That's it.